أحسن الحديث كتابا متشابها كتابا متشابها مثانية تقشعر منه جلود الذين يخشون ربهم ثم تلين جلودهم وقلوبهم إلى ذكر الله.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. I welcome you to another episode of our series, The Sciences of the Quran. This is your host, Yasir Qadhi. In today's episode, we're going to talk about a categorization that the scholars of Islam have used since the earliest time. And this categorization is the categorization of the Makki and Madani verses and the Makki and Madani surahs. Now, we all know that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam received the Quran for a period of 23 years. 13 of them were in Mecca and 10 of them were in Medina. The situation of the Muslims in Mecca was very different than the situation in Medina. In Mecca they were weak, in Mecca they were powerless, in Mecca they were at the mercy of a far more powerful entity, and that is the Quraysh. Also in Mecca, the laws of Islam had not been revealed. Even the prayer was obligated right at the end of the Meccan stage. And there was no such thing as the legal laws of Islam of marriage and divorce and inheritance. All of these were not present. In Medina, on the other hand, the situation was the exact opposite. The Muslims were in charge. The Prophet ﷺ was a political and a social and an economic leader. He did and he decided everything. So the Quran came down to cater to that situation. Laws were revealed, laws were passed, legislations were made. Also, the Quran talks about the engagements of the Muslims politically, militarily. The whole situation has changed from Mecca to Medina. Therefore, it is no surprise to find that the revelation styles and the content is different from Mecca to Medina. And this science of categorizing the verses based upon their source of revelation, where did their location of revelation, excuse me, not the source, but where were they revealed? This science was even understood by the companions themselves. One of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, he said, "I swear by Allah that there is no verse that has been revealed, no surah that has been revealed, except that I know why it was revealed. And there's not a single revelation except that I know the reason and the cause of that revelation. And if it were possible that I knew anybody who was more knowledgeable than me, I would go and study with him no matter what the cost." Meaning, I'm so eager to obtain knowledge that I would get any type of information from him no matter what the cost. In another statement of one of the companions, he said, "Ask me about the book of Allah, for I swear by Allah, there is not a single verse except that I know whether it was revealed at night or in the day, whether it was revealed while the Prophet ﷺ is traveling or while he is resident in the city." So it is not surprising then that the companions informed us a lot about the context of revelation, the time period of revelation. For example, we learned that Surah At-Tawbah, verse 118, it was revealed at Tabuk, at the place called Tabuk, in the last third of the night when the Prophet ﷺ was resting with Umm Salama. This is what the hadith tells us. In another hadith, Ibn Mas'ud said, "Once we were with the Prophet ﷺ in one of the caves of Mina outside of Mecca when Allah revealed Surah number 77, Wal-Mursalati Urfa." And we also learn, for example, that the phrase "Wallahu ya'simuka minan nas," Allah will protect you from mankind, was revealed at night when the Prophet ﷺ was in a tent surrounded by companions who were acting like bodyguards to him. And when Allah revealed, "Allah will protect you from mankind," the Prophet ﷺ lifted up the door of the tent and he said to the Sahaba around him, "O people, you may now leave, you may go back to your tents. Allah has promised to protect me, so I don't need you as bodyguards." So, we were told this extra information which tells us the place and the location and maybe even the precise timing of revelation. So what exactly is the Makki and Madani verse? Well, a Makki verse is a verse that has been revealed before the Hijrah. And a Madani verse is one that has been revealed after the Hijrah. So what is important is not the physical location, but rather the time frame. For you see, the Prophet ﷺ was in Mecca for 13 years, and he went to other places as well. He went to the outer plains of Mina and Muzdalifah and Arafat. He went to the city of Ta'if. When he was in Medina, he traveled to many places. He traveled in the direction of Tabuk. He even returned to Mecca in the farewell pilgrimage. And in the conquest of Mecca, he returned. And yet, if the Qur'an that was revealed in the farewell pilgrimage, even though it was revealed in Mecca, we still call it Madani, because we're looking at the time frame. We're looking at the place, we're looking at the chronological order of the verses. If the verse was revealed before the immigration to Medina, we call it Makki. And if the verse was revealed after the immigration, we call it Madani. Hence, what is important is not the geographic location, it is the date of the Hijrah. Question arises, how do we know Makki and Madani verses? Where does this knowledge come from? And the response is that, well, there are two ways to get this knowledge, one of which is a sure way, and the other one of which is an educated guess. The sure way of obtaining this knowledge is to rely upon the statements of the companions. This is because the companions many times would tell us quite explicitly where the verse was revealed or when it was revealed. So they would say, this verse came down, for example, in the Masjid of Quba. And if it came down in the Masjid of Quba, then it must be Madani. Or they would say, this verse came down when Abu Jahl said such and such to the Prophet ﷺ, and if that is the case, then it must be Makki. So by looking at the information that we get from the companions, we may explicitly state, this verse was revealed before the Hijrah, and that verse was revealed after the Hijrah. But we don't have such information for every single verse or surah. We do for quite a lot, and we don't also for quite a lot. So this can also lead us to another way of finding out how a verse is Makki or Madani, and that is via an educated guess, but from the scholars of Islam, not from me and you. How is there an educated guess done? Simple. The scholar looks at the attributes of the Makki and Madani revelations. He looks at the characteristics of the Makki and Madani revelations. He looks at the common themes of the Makki and Madani revelations, and then he judges which category does this verse or surah come under. And he makes an educated guess, called in Arabic an ijtihad. And this ijtihad, it could be right, it could be wrong, but the scholar must state, I am getting this from my own opinion, Allah knows if it is right or wrong. And of course, if a companion says so, that this verse was revealed at that time, then surely the companion knows when it was revealed because he witnessed the revelation. So these are the two ways of obtaining the Makki or Madani aspect of the verse. One of them is foolproof, and that is when the companion tells you, because the companions were alive when the Qur'an was revealed, they witnessed the revelation. And the other one of which is not foolproof, it could be prone to error, and so scholars can try their best to give an educated guess. How do they give an educated guess? As I said, by looking at the attributes and characteristics of the Makki and Madani surahs. There are a number of attributes that the Makki and Madani surahs have. For example, the Makki surahs have as common themes the call to the pure worship of Allah and the establishment of a basis of theology. This is one of the themes of the Makki surah. Establishment of beliefs, affirming the hereafter, description of the day of judgment, heaven and hell, resurrection, the angels, the prophets, stories of the prophets. This is a common Makki theme. Likewise, the establishment of morality in a very broad basis, not specific rulings. Also, stories of the previous generations is a common theme of the Makki revelations. In contrast, the Madani revelations are different. The Madani revelations are more dealing with the perfection of the rituals of worship. In the Madani verses, the detailed laws of prayer, of sacrifice, of how to wage war with your enemies, of inheritance, of marriage and divorce, these have come down. So the establishment of a system of laws governing the individual, governing the society, governing the family, governing international relations, all of this is a Madani phenomenon. There is nothing in the Makki revelations with regards to these detailed laws of Islam. Also, the discussion that occurs regarding Jews and Christians is primarily a Madani phenomenon. There were no references to Judaism or Christianity in the Meccan phase. Also, a discussion of the plots and the evil nature and the characteristics of the hypocrites, the munafiqun, this too is a purely Madani phenomenon. There were no hypocrites in Mecca. Hypocrites began in the Madani phase. So every single reference to hypocrisy in the Quran is a Madani revelation. Also, we find some specific characteristics of the Makki and Madani surahs, the styles. The Makki surahs are the ones that have the oaths in them with the word kalla. So the word kalla, anytime it occurs, it is a Makki surah. Also, all of the surahs that begin with the disjointed letters, Alif Lam Mim, Ha Mim, all of these, they are Makki except for Baqarah and Al Imran. And we find that the Makki surahs are shorter, generally speaking. They're much more fiery eloquence, whereas the Madani surahs and revelations and verses are longer, and the eloquence is of a different type. It is obviously eloquent, but not of the type of the eloquence of the Meccan, because the Meccan is short and succinct and to the point, and there's a lot more what we call in Arabic targhib and tarheeb, making you scared of Allah's punishment and wanting you to receive Allah's mercy. There's a lot more of that in the Makki surahs than there is in the Madani surahs. Some of the benefits of knowing Makki and Madani surahs: this knowledge is essential in arriving at a proper understanding and interpretation of the verse. If we don't know Makki and Madani, then we're always going to be at a disadvantage, not fully understanding the verse. For example, Allah says in the Quran, in Surah number 28, verse 85, that verily, he who has given you the Qur'an will also cause you to return from where you came from. Now, how do we know where he came from? What is this verse about? When we study that this verse was revealed when the Prophet ﷺ left Mecca to go to Medina, we understand Allah is saying, you are now leaving Mecca. A time will come when you will return to it from Medina. So by understanding Makki and Madani, we understand the meaning of the verse. Also, this knowledge helps us in differentiating abrogated verses from non-abrogated ones. And we'll talk about abrogation in a future lesson. Also, it gives us an insight into the psychology of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and it helps us appreciate the biography of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In the Makki verses, Allah is consoling him for certain things. In the Madani verses, he's consoling him for other things. So we get a glimpse of the seerah through the Makki and Madani verses. Likewise, the Makki and Madani verses helps us appreciate how our own religion was established, starting with morality and theology, then building up to legal laws. And this helps us in our methodology of da'wah. We too, when we call to Islam, we follow this process. We start with theology, we start with morality, and then we work our way up to the legal codes of Islam. So, to summarize today's lesson, the concept of Makki and Madani is a very important science amongst the sciences of the Qur'an, and it helps us in differentiating the verses and surahs that were revealed in Mecca from those that were revealed in Medina. And this is an important science in understanding the Qur'an. This brings us to the conclusion of today's episode. InshaAllah ta'ala, I hope to see you next time. Until then, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
الله نزل أحسن الحديث كتابا متشابها مثانية تقشعر منه جلود الذين يخشون ربهم ثم تلين جلودهم وقلوبهم إلى ذكر الله.